Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. In the earlier sessions we discussed about the valuation of perquisites, in which particularly the valuation of perquisite in respect of rent free accommodation we have discussed earlier. Now let us continue the discussion on valuation of some more perquisites. And one of the very important such valuations is the valuation of perquisite in respect of motor car that is provided by the employer to the employee. So that is what is the subject matter here, motor car provided by the employer to the employee. And we know that it is going to be taxable only in the hands of specified employees. But one more point to be noted here is, if at all this vehicle is provided by the company or employer only for travel between office and residence, if at all this vehicle is given to the employee only for travel between office and residence, it shall not be regarded as a benefit. That means it is not taxable. So if the question says vehicle is provided to the employee for commuting between office and residence, not taxable, that is not even considered as a benefit. But remember once again, if at all transport allowance is given by the employer to the employee for commuting between office and residence, that would have been fully taxable. But if car is provided by employer to the employee for the same purpose, it is not taxable. Then what are we talking about here? We are talking about the motor car given by employer to employee, particularly for personal purposes. Sometimes it is partly personal, partly official. Then also, how to calculate the value of perquisite in respect of motor car is what this table tells us. And here, usually the valuation of perquisite here happens monthly, that is the calendar month, per month this much. Even if it is part of the month also, it is considered as a full month, and monthly valuation will happen, and naturally we have to convert into annual valuation depending upon the number of months for which the car is provided. Always care has to be taken. Even for the house also and car also, how many number of months the perquisite is provided, to those many number of months only it will be taxable. Blindly you cannot multiply with 12 always. You have to check the question whether the perquisite is provided throughout the year or is it provided for a certain portion of the year. If it is provided only for a certain part of the year, it will be taxable only to that extent. So this perquisite in respect of motor car is valued according to the following table on a monthly basis, which will be multiplied with the number of months for which the car has been provided by the employer to the employee. And now let us look at different situations here. Lot of situations are there. We have to be very careful with different scenarios. First and foremost thing, where the motor car is owned or hired by the employer. Motor car is owned or hired by the employer, but car is provided by employer. Definitely employee does not own the car, employer either owns it or hires it and then gives in turn to the employee. And then again, further possibilities, it is used wholly and exclusively for the performance of his official duties. When the car is provided by the employer to employee for the performance of official duties, where is perquisite in that? There is no perquisite. So nothing to discuss about it. It is not a perquisite at all. It is not. However, certain documents have to be maintained by employer. Those will be maintained. So that's not a point for us. It is practically an administrative issue where employer would require to maintain certain documents to prove that the car is used wholly for official duties. That he will anyway do. But find for us the point is if the car is given to the employee for exclusively official duties, then there is no perquisite at all. And here the classification of the perquisite here, if you observe, is depending upon the cubic capacity of the engine of the car does not exceed 1.6 liters or if it exceeds 1.6 liters. So if engine capacity of the car, that is what popularly we call it CC, 1.6 liters means generally around 1600 CC. Again, we don't have to be automobile engineers here to check exactly is it CC 1.6 liters equal to 1600 CC or not. It will not be exactly 1600 CC, it will be somewhere around 1600 CC. We don't need all that. That is all technical data. Better to leave it to motor mechanics and automobile engineers. For us, what is important? Whether the capacity of the car is exceeding 1.6 liters or not. If the cubic capacity of the engine does not exceed 1.6 liters, does not exceed 1.6 liters means 1.6 liters also falls in the same category, because 1.6 liters means it is not exceeding 1.6 liters. So the first column, that is the third column here, we are talking about less than or equal to 1.6 liters. That is what we should be clear, because in the examinations, these are the border areas where they will try to confuse. We should not be confused if we have clarity about what exactly this word is telling. The word is does not exceed 1.6 liters. That means even 1.6 liters also is something which is not exceeding 1.6 liters. So less than or equal to 1.6 liters is first category. The second one says the cubic capacity exceeds 1.6 liters, which means this will be falling in the category of more than or greater than 1.6 liters. That is the two categories. But anyway, in this first scenario, it doesn't matter because the car is exclusively used for official duties. When it is used for official duties, it is not a perquisite, So nothing is taxable, simple. So this first scenario, nothing to calculate, only to identify that if the car is provided for official duties, it is not a perquisite. And same way, if the car is provided for commuting between office and residence also, it is not a perquisite. Now, what if the car is provided, the next case, exclusively for private purposes or personal purposes? Exclusively for private purposes or personal purposes, whatever we call it, of the employee or any member of his household, that's okay. But the car is provided by employer to the employee and employee is using it exclusively for personal purposes, and not only that, and the running and maintenance expenses are met or reimbursed by employer. So what is happening here? First of all, car is owned by employer or hired by employer, then it is given to employee for private purposes, exclusively personal purposes, and the expenses related to the car also, running and maintenance expenses, running expenses like petrol, diesel, etc., maintenance expenses like repairs and maintenance, etc., those are all met by employer only, because car is also given by employer, expenses are also met by employer, and car is exclusively used for private purposes. So whatever the real value of this perquisite should be is fullest possible extent. So what is the value of perquisite here? Actual amount of expenditure really incurred by the employer, whatever it is, because he is incurring it, whatever the amount of expenditure he incurs it, that itself will be the value of perquisite. Nothing for us to calculate, it depends upon the fact. And if at all any remuneration paid to the chauffeur by the employer, that should be added. Chauffeur means driver, if at all. How much actual, whatever actually paid by employer to the driver also should be added as a perquisite, because the car is used for exclusively private purposes, you have to observe that. And not only that, we have to also increase it, representing the normal wear and tear of the motor car as reduced by the amount charged from employee for such use. So the last one is always there, as reduced by. amount charged from employee. Always that will be there for any perquisite, not only here. If any amount is recovered from employee after calculation of the value of perquisite, it will be reduced from the value of perquisite, but that will happen after the computation of value of perquisite. So how to calculate value of perquisite here? Actually nothing special. Once again, it is all about actual expenses incurred by employer, actual salary paid by employer to the driver, and some amount representing the normal wear and tear of the motor car. See, naturally the main point here or the problem here comes with this normal wear and tear. What is this normal wear and tear? How much should be considered as normal wear and tear? Because the topic has come, we don't need to wait for this to be explained separately. Let us understand here itself. What is that normal wear and tear for what the employer is giving some benefit to the employee, but how to value that normal wear and tear? Simple. There are, once again, two possibilities only. One, the car was hired by the employer, then naturally the actual hire charges paid by employer will be taken related to the car. If the car is owned by the employer, just like in the case of furniture, 10% of the cost, 10% of the cost of the car per annum, 10% per annum will be considered as normal wear and tear. That's it. And if you remember, the same 10% was there for furniture also. In fact, for all the movable assets, generally this 10% is common. Exceptions will be there, we will see them later, but in general for all the movable assets, whether it is furniture or motor car, then how much will be the value of perquisite for these type of movable assets is 10% per annum. So here also it is the same 10% per annum when, if the car is owned by the employer. If the car is hired by employer, actual hire charges will be taken as value of perquisite, and there is nothing different between this point and the point that we already discussed about furniture. Both are same. So that is about when the employer owns the car or hires the car, and the car is given to the employee for personal purposes, and expenses are also met by the employer. So will there be any difference of 1.6 liter more than 1.6 liter? Nothing. Because whatever actual expenditure is incurred, that itself is the value of perquisite. Whatever the remuneration paid, if any, to the chauffeur, that itself will be added. And that will be increased by naturally the amount of normal wear and tear of the motor car, which means either actual hire charges or 10% of the cost of the car, not WDV, anything else, 10% of the original cost of the car per annum will be the value of perquisite. If there is any amount recovered from employee, that will be reduced. All things are same. So as far as exclusively private purposes is concerned, no difference. Exclusively official purposes also, no difference. If the car is given exclusively for official purposes, anyway there is no perquisite. If the car is given for exclusively private purposes, then it is taxable irrespective of the size of the car, on the basis of the actual expenditure incurred and on the basis of the actual cost of the car. So we don't have to check 1.6 liter and all. In both the cases, if the car is used for exclusively private purposes also, exclusively official purposes also, naturally there will not be much for us to do in those cases. So less likely to be asked as a question. What is more likely to be asked as a question is the next one, where the car is used partly for official purposes and partly for personal purposes. That is the point. Then becomes difficult. So how much for official, how much for personal? Can he have all the details of each and every kilometer? This many kilometers for official, this many kilometers for personal. Practically, it is just impossible. Nobody knows that. So what we generally call it, just partly official, partly personal purposes the car is used. Then who is meeting the expenses here? Who is meeting the expenses here? Again, two possibilities. Expenses are met or reimbursed by employer. That is one case. In that case, what will be the value of perquisite? This is what you have to remember. If the car is less than or equal to 1.6 liters, 1800 rupees per month, that is monthly. We have to keep that in mind. if chauffeur is provided, if only, if not provided, don't automatically add 900. If chauffeur is provided, then chauffeur means driver. 900 per month will be the value of perquisite. Directly flat, we have to calculate according to this rule. There is nothing special. No logic here. Why 1800? Why 900? We are not the ones to ask. The law told this, we have to just know that. So 1800 rupees per month and 900 rupees per month for a driver, which is common in all cases, will be considered as value of perquisite if the car is having a cubic capacity of less than or equal to 1.6 liters. If the car is having a capacity of more than 1.6 liters, then the amount of value of perquisite will be 2400 rupees per month. 900 per month for chauffeur is standard, same here also, there is no difference. But once again, don't be under a wrong impression, like unnecessary thoughts some people will do. How can a chauffeur live his life with 900 rupees and all? First of all, you should realize, Income Tax Act is not telling anybody how much to pay to their chauffeur. It is none of our business. And Income Tax Act is not telling whether chauffeur should be provided or not. That is also none of our business. It is only valuing the perquisite. That's all. Nothing else. How much the employer will give to chauffeur? How do we know? Why do we care? But we care when. If the car was used wholly for personal purposes, then how much ever actually the employer pays to the chauffeur, that will be taken into consideration because it was a perquisite fully. But here the problem is, it is partly perquisite. Partly personal, partly official. Official portion cannot be called as perquisite. And it is practically impossible to almost bifurcate these two. So what the law said, don't worry about bifurcation and all. We are telling you some amount. Use that amount. That's it. So what is the value of perquisite in that case? If the car is provided by the employer and the car is owned by the employer or hired by the employer and expenses are also met by the employer and the car is used for partly private and partly official purposes, then what is the value of perquisite? These many ifs are there. Then the value of perquisite is 1800 rupees per month if, once again, one more if, the cubic capacity or the engine capacity of the car is less than or equal to 1.6 liters. Or 2400 per month if the engine capacity is more than 1.6 liters. Sir, how do we know which car is which, how much capacity? That is none of our business. We don't have to be experts of that. It will be given in the question whether the car is less than 1.6 liters or more than 1.6 liters. But just for general knowledge, if it is given that employer has given a Hyundai Santro car, something like that, then small cars definitely are less than 1.6 liters. With that common sense, you can proceed with that. If that also we cannot assume or we cannot imagine, then there is every right to assume that this car is less than or more than 1.6 liters. I would suggest generally, if nothing is given, assume that it is less than or equal to 1.6 liters. Most of the cars that we normally see on the road, sedans particularly, are less than or equal to 1.6 liter only. Rarely the cars are more than 1.6 liters, like Innovas, bigger cars, those are all Fortuners, those are bigger ones. So that cannot be assumed unnecessarily. So what is normal, common is less than 1.6 liters, if a doubt persists. But if the question is clear, it is mentioning that a Hyundai Santro car is given or a Maruti Alto car is given, I will assume it is more than 1.6 liters, doesn't make sense. So reading the facts of the case is, as usual, always very, very important. But what is the provision numbers that is to be remembered ultimately? 1800 or 2400 per month is the value of perquisite. If chauffeur is provided, 900 per month is to be added to the value of perquisite, already what is calculated, using 1800 per month or 2400 per month. But this is when the expenses are met by employer. So what if the expenses are fully met by the SSC, and naturally SSC is employee. If the employer is not meeting expenses, but SSC is meeting his own expenses, then where is perquisite? Yes, there is perquisite still. Why? Here, car is provided by employer only. Expenses are just met by employee. Car is still a perquisite. Car is still a benefit or a facility or an amenity that is provided by employer to the employee. So there is perquisite value, but naturally it will be lesser than the earlier one. So now, how much will be the value of perquisite? Either 600 or 900. That is the value of perquisite towards the provision of motor car by employer to employee when, if the expenses are met by employee, then 600 or 900 as the case may be. If the expenses are met by employer, then 1800 or 2400 per month as the case may be. Driver salary 900 is always the same. There is no change in that. But when do we need all this? When the car is used for partly official purposes and partly private purposes, and employer is giving the car, who either owns it or hires it. That was the first category of perquisites in respect of motor car. You need to remember these things very well. If a car is used for wholly official purposes, there is no perquisite. If car is used for wholly private purposes, then whatever actual expenditure incurred plus 10% of cost of the car or hire charges plus actual salary paid to the driver, if given, will be the value of perquisite irrespective of the size of the car. But if the car is provided by employer, but it is used for partly official and partly private purposes, and expenses are borne by employer also, then 1800 or 2400 per month will be the value of perquisite depending upon capacity of the car. If the car is provided by employer and expenses are met by employee, and the car is used for partly official, partly private purposes, then 600 per month or 900 per month, as the case may be, will be the value of perquisite. That is the summary of first category, where the car was provided by employer. Now, second case, if you look at it, employee has a car. If employee has a car, that is not a perquisite, right? Employer giving him car is a perquisite. Employee has his own car, let us say, he is incurring his own expenditure, then there is no benefit coming from employer. But even then there could be a benefit. Why? Because employee might own the car, employer can meet the running and maintenance charges. Then there is a perquisite, definitely yes. So what is this case? Employee owns the car, but the actual running and maintenance charges are met or reimbursed to him by employer. So the expenses of the running and maintenance of the car are met by employer. But car is not employer's car, it is employee's own car. Then naturally, once again, a lot of other things will come. What if this is used for official purposes? As usual, not a perquisite. Simple. What if it is used for fully personal purposes? Then it also is not a perquisite, naturally. Why? Fully personal purposes, actual expenses will be incurred if it is fully personal purposes. If it is the expenses are also incurred by employee, then it will not be a perquisite, because employee himself is owning the car and he is using his own car, incurring his own expenses for his own personal purposes. There is no benefit given by employer in that case. But here that is not the case. Here what we are talking, car is owned by employee, but expenses are met by employer, and car is used for official purposes, it is not a perquisite. What if it is used for private purposes? So looks like here this material is a little messed up. Don't follow this. This is wrong here, because the B point here is saying it is used for partly official, partly private, but explanation says the actual amount of expenditure incurred. So actual amount of expenditure incurred by employer will be when relevant. That will be relevant when the car is used for exclusively personal purposes. There are always three different cases. One, the car is used for exclusively official duties. That was A point here. B, car is used for exclusively private purposes. Then C, car is used for both official and private purposes. But here that was missing. By mistake, they have taken this here. So this should be separate. It is not here. So what ideally this should be, when we say this actual amount of expenditure incurred itself will become value of perquisite. So this is not B case. Actually, the B case is what? When the car is used completely, exclusively for private purposes, completely personal purposes, 100%. Then, naturally, whatever the amount of expenditure incurred by employer will be taxable as value of perquisite. So that should be point B, not what is given there. So exclusively official purposes, not a perquisite. Exclusively private purposes, actual amount of expenditure incurred by employer. But of course, if you observe, normal wear and tear is not there here. Why? Because the car is here owned by employee himself. Employer is not giving the car. Employee is owning the car. Employer is only meeting the expenses. So in this case, if the car is used for exclusively private purposes, whatever the expenditure incurred by employer will be treated as value of perquisite. Now the C point, actually it should be, not B. So whatever is given here ideally should be C. So the B point is this, which is when the car is used for exclusively private purposes, then the actual amount incurred will be treated as value of perquisite. C point is different. That is when the car is used partly for official purposes and partly for personal purposes. So the car is used for partly official purposes, partly personal purposes. Then how much will be the value of perquisite? That is to be separately looked at. So when we look at this third category, where the employer meets the actual expenditure of running and maintenance of the car, and the car is used for partly official and partly personal. So what is given here is also okay, but they are not writing it clearly. Rather, they are telling that the actual expenditure as reduced by the item number 1C1 above. So again, we have to go to 1C1 and see what was that. So what was 1C1? If you see, that was 1800 and 2400 per month. So we don't need to have cross references here. Simply, the provision is here. Actual expenditure minus of 1800 or 2400 per month. That's it. That is the provision for valuation of perquisite. What you have to take? Actual expenditure who incurred here? Actual expenditure is incurred by employer naturally. Minus of 1800 per month or minus of 2400 per month. That will be the value of perquisite in the C case, where the car is used for partly official, partly private purposes. Of course, the one which was missing here is B, where the car was used completely, exclusively for private purposes. Then entire actual amount of expenditure incurred by employer will be the value of perquisite. But if the car is used for partly official, partly private purposes, then actual amount of expenditure incurred by employer minus of 1800 per month or 2400 per month will be the value of perquisite in such case. So that is about the valuation of perquisite in respect of motor car. In a nutshell, everything has to be just written also by you as a summary. Where the car is owned by employer or hired by employer and it is given to the employee for the purpose of performance of official duties, it is not a perquisite. And if it is used for private purposes or completely personal purposes, and running and maintenance expenses are also met by employer, then whatever expenditure incurred by employer plus 10% per annum of the cost of the car or higher charges paid by employer, as the case may be, will be treated as value of perquisite. But if the car is used for partly official, partly private purposes, and there we have to also see where the car is also given by employer, expenses are also met by employer, then the value of perquisite is 1800 per month or 2400 per month. But if only car is given by employer but expenses are met by employee, then the value of perquisite is 600 per month and 900 per month, with a chauffeur salary to be added of 900 per month in any case. Same way, if the employee owns the car but employer gives the expenses related to the car, and car is used for official purposes, it cannot be a perquisite. If it is used for private purposes, then whatever expenditure incurred by employer becomes perquisite. If it is used for partly official, partly private purposes, then actual expenditure incurred by employer, which is reality, minus of 1800 per month or 2400 per month will be the value of perquisite in that case when the car is owned by employee, but expenses of running and maintenance are paid or reimbursed by employer and car is used for both official or private purposes. And 1800 when, 2400 when, that depends upon the capacity of the car. Less than or equal to 1.6 liters, 1800 per month. More than 1.6 liters, 2400 per month. Once again, I would like to draw the attention of these numbers. People do mistakes here. Earlier, the value of perquisite itself was 1800 and 2400. That was the value of perquisite earlier. Here, the value of perquisite is not 1800, 2400. It is actual expenditure minus 1800 or 2400. So, understand the difference. Earlier, there was no reference to actual expenditure. Here, actual expenditure also matters. From that, we have to deduct either 1800 or 2400 as the case may be. That's it. That is about perquisite in respect of motor car. Then, what if employee owns any other automotive, like for example, bike or something else, not car, but actual expenses are reimbursed by employer? Naturally, if it is used for official purposes, not a perquisite. If it is used for fully private purposes, actual expenditure, that logic has to be applied here also. But only point is, what if it is used for partly official, partly personal purposes? Then actual amount of expenditure incurred minus 900 per month. So if it was car, then it was actual expenditure minus 1800 or 2400 per month. If it is not a car, if it is a bike or any other automotive, then actual expenditure minus 900 per month. Any automotive, the word is used. So we can just use that liberal interpretation. In general, what automotive the people will take other than car? Bikes only, they will take two wheelers, let us say. What if the employer gives auto to employee to come to office? What if the employer gives tractor to employee to come to office? Still the same provision is applicable because the law says any automotive, but that is very unlikely. So yes, we can have some thoughts about what possibilities are there, but at the same time, we have to also follow the general norms, what happens in reality. So any other vehicle other than car, if the employer is meeting the expenses of that, then whatever the amount of expenditure incurred by the employer minus 900 per month will be the value of perquisite. Okay, that is the value of perquisite in respect of motor car. Now some other special points will be there. What if more than one motor car is provided by the employer to the employee? Then what should we do? What should we do? If the question says employer gives two cars and both are used for partly official, partly personal, then can we say both of them as partly official, partly personal? Answer is no. We cannot take that. There what we have to assume here, the point what the law says here is, if at all more than one motor car is provided by employer to the employee, then only the value of perquisite in respect of one car can be calculated as if one car is used for partly official and partly personal purposes. And what about the remaining cars? They will be considered or deemed to have been exclusively used for private or personal purposes. Full amount becomes taxable, not 1800, 2400, 600, 900, no. Full amount will be taxable, whatever the actual expenditure incurred, and if the employer provides the car, 10% of the cost of the car or higher charges will be taxable. So what is the essence of this? If more than one motor car is provided, you cannot say all are used for partly official, partly personal, not possible. Only you can choose one such car as partly official, partly personal, where the law has given the calculation, and all the remaining cars will be deemed to be, they are all presumed to be used for exclusively private purposes, which means valuation happens according to actual expenses, not according to the amounts given in the law. So that is one point to be noted. Documents to be maintained by employers, that's okay, they will maintain. Why should we worry about them? They will maintain, that is practical thing. And what is normal wear and tear? Already we have taken that. What is normal wear and tear here? 10% per annum of the actual cost of the motor car is what is called as normal wear and tear. If the car was owned by employer, what if the car was hired by employer and then in turn given to employee, then actual hire charges itself will be the value of perquisite in that case. Then that is about motor car perquisite, very, very important one. Different multiple possibilities we should be knowing the provision first, and once you know the provision, remaining is just observation of the facts in the question and using the facts for applying the provision to that facts and get the answer. But what is important is what permutations, combinations are there. Car is owned by employer, expenses are also met by employer, car is used for exclusively official purposes, no perquisite, one option. Car is given by and you are owned by employer, expenses are also met by employer, and the car is used for exclusively personal purposes, then actual expenditure incurred by employer plus normal wear and tear, which is 10% of the actual cost, will be the value of perquisite. Then car is given by employer, owned or hired by employer, but given by employer to employee, expenses are also met by employer, and car is used for partly official, partly personal purposes, then the value of perquisite will be either 1800 per month or 2400 per month according to the capacity of the car. Car is given by employer, used for partly official, partly private purposes, but the expenses are met by employee, then 600 per month or 900 per month will be the value of perquisite. In all these cases, 900 per month chauffeur salary will be added. If chauffeur is provided, then only, otherwise no. These many possibilities are there. And still some more possibilities are there. Car is owned by employee and expenses are met by employer. Then car is used for wholly official purposes, not a perquisite. Car is used for wholly private purposes, actual expenditure will be the perquisite. Car is used for partly private, partly official purposes, then actual expenditure minus 1800 per month or 2400 per month, as the case may be, will be treated as value of perquisite in such case. So what is the case that is going to be actually given in the examination? We have to look from the facts and information that is given in the question. Accordingly, we have to apply the relevant provision, that is the perquisite in respect of motor car. Now, look at the other one. What about the perquisite in providing domestic servant? See, domestic servant, we already discussed it. Could be watchman, gardener, like that. Sweeper, personal attendant, watchman, all these people, any of these people are called generally domestic servants. Not necessarily the same names, any other names also can be given. But simply the point is, this servant is working at employee's home, not officially for office purposes. So is not official assistant, is a personal assistant, that is domestic servant we can call. But here there are two possibilities only. One, if the domestic servant is engaged by the employee and employer pays the money to the servants, or employer reimburses that money to the employee, then it will be a perquisite in the hands of all employees. Why is that? Because that is obligation of employee met by employer. When domestic servant is engaged by employee and employer is paying the salary of that domestic servant. But if the domestic servant is engaged by employer, employee is not engaging, employer himself is engaging the domestic servant, of course, the facility of such servant is provided to the employee. Then what? Then it will be taxable only in the hands of specified employees. That's it. How much will be taxable, sir? Whatever the value of benefit that employer actually gives, that will be taxable. There is no limit, sir. There is no amounts here mentioned. Now onwards, many perquisites will be there which will depend upon actual amounts spent by employer. So they have to be just remembered. Generally, there is nothing to specifically remember there. Whatever the amount of salary of domestic servants paid by employer, that itself will be the value of perquisite. That's it. So simply speaking, actual cost incurred by employer will be the value of perquisite, and this will be always there as reduced by amount paid by employee or recovered from employee. That will be always there. So that is common sense point. But value of perquisite, nothing to specially calculate. It will be the real expenditure incurred by employer only. But what is the key point here in the case of domestic servant is we have to check who appointed the domestic servant. Did employee appoint? Employer appointed. Employee appointed, that means it is obligation of employee met by employer. Because employee appointed the domestic servant, salary of the domestic servant is paid by employer. That falls under the category of obligation of employee met by employer, which is taxable in all cases. In the second case, if employer only appointed the domestic servant and then later he has provided that some domestic servant service to the employee at his home, that becomes a perquisite also. But that will be a taxable perquisite only in the hands of specified employees. That is the only difference here. And that's what is asked also in the illustration number 18. Mr. X and Mr. Y are working with Gamma Limited. As per the salary fixation norms, the following perquisites were offered. For Mr. X, let us see, who engaged a domestic servant at the rate of 500 per month? Who engaged? X himself engaged. Means employee has engaged. But the employer reimbursed the entire salary, that is 500 per month, to Mr. X. What about the taxability in the hands of Mr. X? Of course it is taxable, because it is taxable in all cases when employee himself engages the domestic servant and employer reimburses the salary of such domestic servant. So 500 per month means 6000 rupees is taxable in the hands of X. Even though he is not a specified employee, still it is taxable. Second case, Y. He was provided with a domestic servant. So just words different and a practical difference. In the case of X, X engaged a domestic servant and employer reimbursed the salary of such domestic servant. In case of Y, employer himself is providing Y with a domestic servant at the rate of 500 per month. That means it is taxable only if Mr. Y is a specified employee. And here in the question it was given, both are not specified employees. So practically it is just illogical, we know that, because persons who do not have a salary or gross salary of not even 1 lakh, they are provided with domestic servants by the employer, is inconceivable. But still, we don't have to worry about them. It's not our job to do research on the problems. Our job is to answer the problems. So the question is giving us data, information, and we have to just process it according to the law and give the answer. So what is the answer? For Mr. X, it is fully taxable. For Mr. Y, it is not taxable. That's it. That is a provision of domestic servant. So for Mr. X, it is taxable. It will be taxable in the hands of Mr. X. Whereas in the case of Y, there is no perquisite element in the hands of Y, since he is not a specified employee. That is a domestic servant. Another perquisite. What if gas, electricity, water is supplied by employer? Naturally, not in the office. Office gas, electricity, water is that is employer's duty. But at the home, at the residential accommodation of the employee, employer is providing the gas, electricity, water. Here also the logic will be same. Just like the domestic servant, if employer reimburses that money for such expenses, like employer pays the gas bill of employee, employer pays the electricity bill of employer, water bill of employee, then that will be taxable in case of all employees, if the employer pays or reimburses such expenses. But on the other side, what if the employer himself provides that to the employee? Then it will be taxable only in the hands of specified employees. Then a question comes, what is the amount or value of perquisite? Whatever the actual cost only will be the value of perquisite. But here there are two possibilities. Employer himself is not providing out of his own sources, but he is paying it to other agency. Some payment is made to other agency. Then whatever the amount paid will be naturally the value of perquisite. But what if employer himself is a gas company? Let us say a gas company HPCL giving its own employees gas cylinders free of cost. Or electricity company like NTPC providing electricity to the employees in their residential colony free of cost. Like that. Then what? They are providing, the employer is providing from their own sources. There is no money that is explicitly spent by employer. So what we have to take? No option. What is the manufacturing cost per unit incurred by the employer? That will be treated as value of perquisite. In both cases, it is just actuals. It has nothing to do with any numbers given in the law. So you just need to remember, if employer provides gas, electricity, water from the own sources, we take the manufacturing cost per unit multiplied with the number of units provided to employee. What if the employer provides gas, electricity, water to employee, but not from his own sources? He procures it from somewhere else and then in turn gives to the employee. Then whatever he pays to that agency, third party, will become the value of perquisite. That's it. That is gas, electricity, water. Now, one more important perquisite that is related to educational facilities. Educational facilities. So, if at all, once again, the school fees of the children of employee or member of household, if it is reimbursed by the employer, if it is paid or reimbursed, these words are important, then it will be a perquisite in the hands of all employees, naturally. That will be taxable. How much, sir? How much ever is paid, that is taxable. However, if the educational facility is provided in the school maintained by employer or in any school by reason of his being having employment with free of cost or concessional rate, then it would be perquisite in the hands of specified employees only. So if at all educational fees or bill or expenditure of employee met by employer, then that is fully taxable for all SSEs. But not that payment or reimbursement is happening, employer himself is providing education to the children of employees. Then what? There we have to look at various circumstances. What if the education institution itself is maintained and owned by employer? In the case of medical, we know it was not taxable. It was not taxable if medical facilities provided to the employees in the hospital owned and maintained by employer. Don't mix that here. Here that is different. Here it is taxable. Taxable. How much will be taxable? The cost of such education in a similar institution in the same or near locality. So that will be the value of perquisite. Because employer is providing the education directly, or the employee is having, or employee's children are having admission in this education institution just because of the reason of being in employment of that employer. So because of that, they got admission there. Both are similar, not much difference. So don't worry about the minute things like that. Employer is providing education to the children of employees. Then where? Either in the school employer himself owns, or in the school in which the employee's children get admission only because of the employment. So in that case, what is the value of perquisite? The cost of such education in a similar institution. Interpretation issues. Liberal interpretation tells us only the excess amount can be taxable. Strict interpretation tells us full amount, entire amount will be taxable. Both ways it can be taken. So it depends upon our choice. How do we take it? Liberal interpretation can very well be taken without any problem, because that gives benefit to the SSE. For example, if the cost of such education in a similar institution is coming to around 1200 rupees per month per child, then we can take 200 per month per child as a taxable value of perquisite. That is also okay. Or we take entire 1200 per month per child also is also okay. Why? Because the law never said 1000 rupees per month is exempted. The law only said there is no perquisite if the value of such education, the cost of such education does not exceed 1000. If the word is very clearly interpreted, we cannot take excess of 1000. We have to take the entire amount as perquisite, because that does not fall under this exceptional category at all. So that is subject to interpretation and subject to our own assumption in the exams. How do we actually apply it? But we have to remember, definitely this 1000 rupees per month per child is the value of perquisite we are talking. It is not money. It is not even fees reimbursement. This is what actually employer providing educational facilities to the employee. But this 1000 rupees is available only to the children of the employee, not for any other household members. Because per child is the word used, so only child is eligible for this 1000 rupees per month per child benefit. So what if the education facility is provided somewhere else? Then there is nothing else. Directly it becomes fully taxable. Whatever the amount of expenditure incurred by employer in this behalf will be taxable. And naturally, always if there is any amount recovered from the employee, that will have to be reduced naturally. That is always there. That is about educational facilities provided by employer to the employee in his own school or own institution. If employer provides, we have to take what would have been the cost of such education in a similar institution in the same or near locality. But if such cost does not exceed 1000 rupees, we can just ignore it as a perquisite. 1000 rupees per month per child. If it exceeds 1000 rupees per month per child, there are two possibilities. We can only take the excess of 1000 rupees as value of perquisite, or we can take the entire amount as value of perquisite as per our interpretation. So don't have to be rigid in such cases, but point is, to have uniformity, we have to stick to something. Strict interpretation or liberal interpretation. And we should not be worried if in the answers, in one question it is solved like this, another question it is solved one more way. We cannot say, I'm getting confused because of that. There is nothing to get confused. Both are possible means both are possible. Both can be done. You can do this way also, that way also. That is not called confusion. That is called options. And we should be sometimes be ready to take options also. Having number of options cannot be called as confusion. It should not be confusion. So it is only knowing that, yes, there are multiple options. I'll choose one according to my convenience or according to my interpretation. That's fine. But if you take a liberal interpretation, I would suggest you take more than excess of 1000 rupees per month, only taxable amount. That is what we can stick to when we solve the questions, if such point occurs. But once again, as I said, that is not a clear one. There will be a gray area as far as that educational perquisite is concerned. It is there. We have to just accept it is there. Then, coming to the other types of perquisites like free tickets or concessional tickets, this is okay. The employer providing free tickets or concessional tickets, where the employer is engaged in the carriage of passengers or goods and is giving free tickets to any employee or member of household for personal or private journey, either free of cost or at concessional rate. And this particular conveyance is available by any other arrangement by such employer for the purpose of transport of passengers. So in any conveyance means not necessarily that is owned by employer only. Even employer is making available such other conveyance to the employee for transport of passengers, whatever it may be. Ultimately, what is happening here? Employer is giving concessional journey to the employee and member of his families, household, you can call it. And that is for personal journey of employee. Then what will be the value of perquisite? Whatever is the actual expenditure normally. But here the point is, employer himself is in the business of carriage of passengers or goods. So what should we do? We should take the value at which such benefit is offered to public. So how much the employer would have charged that amount to public if public were given such tickets or sold with such tickets, as reduced by the amount if any paid or recovered from employee. So this is a one more unnecessary provision I don't know what was the thought process of the lawmakers, but they wanted it, they kept it, can't help it. Nonsense, trash, will be also there, we have to just bear with that. Why nonsense? This says, no such perquisite will be applicable for employees of airlines or railways. So who is left, sir? The truck drivers you are going to tax, the RTC small conductors, drivers, which are small employees you are going to tax. What nonsense is that? If at all there is any real value will be there, that will be there for employees of airlines, big value. Railways okay to some extent, that is no perquisite for them. Then who are the other remaining people in India who are in the business of carriage of passengers or goods? Only buses and trucks. Buses and trucks, so okay, ships and all, very rare scenario. So we are going to say that if after all a small RTC employee takes his family to a personal trip and RTC did not charge him for that ticket, according to this rule, we have to calculate how much RTC would have charged if it has sold a ticket to a normal passenger, and that will be value of perquisite in the hands of this small middle class driver or conductor. That's what the rule says. So when the rule itself is ridiculous, reality will be double ridiculous. Nobody will even report it to anybody. So this is absolutely rubbish. We know many times RTC employees just get into the bus and they say staff. That's all. Who knows? Our income tax officer is going to check that, whether the journey performed for official purposes, private purposes. Complete nonsense. I mean, doesn't make any sense. Such type of rules. Something suddenly strikes their brain and they just vomit on the paper. Sometimes that is why these type of provisions will stink. They don't make sense. Even children's education also, logically speaking, you tell that it is taxable or you tell that it is not taxable. How much would have been charged in a similar institution? What if there is no similar institution in the same locality? Question marks. So lot of gray areas will be there in all this. And even 1,000 rupees exemption also was not clear. So a lot of things are not really good when it comes to this rules part. But still, we have to use them wherever such points are given in the questions. Definitely, yes, that is our job. Though sometimes it looks very awkward. Some things are very clear. For example, rent-free accommodation, super clear. Motor car, fantastic. These two are calculation based, very clearly given how to calculate the value of perquisite. Other things like domestic servant or provision of free gas, electricity, water, clear. There is no much ambiguity in those cases. Those are all very clear. But certain things are little vague and practically useless, like what we have seen earlier also. Refreshments provided during office hours is not taxable. Lunch provided is not taxable only if it does not exceed 50 rupees per meal. So what is refreshment, nobody knows. What is meal, nobody knows. What is lunch, nobody knows. All these words are vague, and these words can be just like that used according to the whims and fancies of the SSA. So ultimately nobody pays 1 rupee tax also towards that. Nobody is going to tell that, oh, this much is my value of perquisite. So rarely anybody reports that. Same thing with this concessional tickets and nonsense. Nobody is going to report that. If at all there was some value applicable, that should be for airline people. That is exempted. No perquisite for employees of airlines or railways. So who are remaining are mostly the non-tax paying category. So practically that is a useless rule, we can say. But can't help it, it is there. So these are some of the perquisites that we discussed. Related to mostly important things are calculation-wise, rent-free accommodation and motor car. Very, very important for calculation. That does not mean remaining are not important. We have to know which are exempt perquisites, and if certain cases like medical or education, how much exempt, in what cases those are exempt, and how much taxable, in what cases those are taxable. These are very important. So rent-free accommodation and motor car, medical and education facilities are definitely four very important perquisites problems wise. And a lot of other things like sweeper, gardener, domestic servant, that will depend upon actual amount only. There is nothing special to remember there, or nothing special to apply some great rule That is just common sense. Whatever is given in the question, multiply with the number of months of provision of such benefit, you will get the value of perquisite. So most of the other things are quite straightforward and clear. And exempt perquisites, as we know already, like provision of mobile or telephone, like that. That list of exempt perquisites that we have seen, that is also equally important. And that list is one more time repeated also later. We'll come to that later. But mostly the valuation of perquisites, the core important perquisites we have discussed already. And in the next session, we can discuss about some more perquisites like interest-free loan or concessional loan or having a, once again, mostly known things, alcoholic, non-alcoholic beverages and all. Gift is one of the important things. Credit card, club expenditure, same logical things. Most important things that we'll discuss in the next class will be the use of movable assets and transfer of movable assets. Very, very important. That we'll discuss in the next session. We'll continue this discussion related to perquisites and hopefully complete the topic of perquisite valuation in the next session. Till that time, take care. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.